Good morning and welcome to the sixth meeting of the Public Audit and Post-Legislative Scrutiny Committee. Can I ask all those present to either switch off their electronic devices or switch them to silent mode so that they do not affect the work of the committee this morning? Item one, the committee is invited to agree to take items 3 and 4 in private. Item 3 is consideration of evidence received under item 2 on the changing models of health and social care report. And item 4 is for the committee to consider its work programme. Do members agree to take these items in private?
Yes.
Thank you very much. Item 2 is an evidence session on the Auditor General for Scotland's report, Changing Models of Health and Social Care. We have already taken oral evidence on this report from the Auditor General, the Scottish Government, and from 2 social care partnerships. We have agreed to take further evidence on the report today, including the extent to which funding decisions are allowing new models of health and social care to develop fully. I'd like to welcome to the meeting this morning Jan Baird, Director of Adult Care, NHS Highland, and Bill Alexander, Director of Care and Learning at Highland Council, the Highland Partnership. I'd also like to welcome Robert Calderwood, Chief Executive, and Mark White, Director of Finance of NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde. And I invite Jan to make a brief opening statement. I understand that NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde do not wish to make an opening statement, is that correct?
Right.
Okay. Jan.
Well, thank you for inviting us and affording us the opportunity to say a few opening words. The Highland Partnership was the first to take the radical step of integration needed in our view to change models of health and social care. The benefits of the lead agency can be summed up as single management, single budgets, single governance. Single management of community health, children and family social work and education in one organisation, the Highland Council. Single management of primary, secondary and community care for adults in one organisation, NHS Highland. Single budgets with a quantum to deliver all of the functions transferred from the commissioning agency to the lead agency. Given the amounts involved, a very brave step for Highland Council in 2012. Single governance with clear accountability across the lead agency, an assurance route to the Commissioner and committees and district partnerships where elected members can be involved, can inform and can scrutinise. Changing models of health and social care needs to be transformational and engaged at every level, individual, team, community, organisation and national. Integration is not a quick fix nor a magic bullet, but alongside strategic commissioning, an evidenced outcome focused approach, genuine and equal partnerships with the third and independent sector, self-management and the rest, it is delivering that change in Highland. It is a journey for which we have a clear plan and a methodology for driving the change that will reduce waste and harm, manage variation and drive up quality. And there are still a number of challenges. How to embed and to sustain some of the changes at community level whilst ensuring the aspirations of the Community Empowerment Act enable that community-driven change. How to work with the Highland pounds, not health or social care pounds, whilst evidencing efficiency and effectiveness to commissioners. How to improve and sustain the flow across and between services and care so that patients and carers don't get caught up in systems or have unnecessary delays. How to plan for increasing demand against a backdrop of reducing funds when the announcements about budget settlements are made at different stages of the planning cycle and changes to budgets and allocations can be made across the year. Highland believes it is essential that we all remain committed to changing models of health and social care, not forgetting that this is about improving lives and work together to evidence the true benefits. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Can I now invite questions from members, please? Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Convener. What's clear from the Auditor General's report is that this is not proceeding as quickly as one would have hoped, or as efficiently as one would have hoped. What are the main challenges that integration authorities are finding in implementing this? Because clearly there's got to be some sort of an acceleration, a step change that's going to permit this to go through, because it is a key policy and it's absolutely essential that this happens.
Convener, if possible, I'll kick off and offer some observations on that. I think the first issue is to understand that the need for change means that we need to be all in agreement that the status quo is not the most desirable outcome in the short to medium term. Therefore, we have to be able to embrace change.
Do you believe that the status quo is sustainable?
I believe that if we were to pursue a model based on the status quo, then there will be no ability, certainly in the short to medium term, particularly the duration of this parliamentary term, to move the significant resources that we aspire into primary and community and prevention services. We have to be very brave and take forward the service redesign that allows us to make the headroom within the overall health economy and health and social care economy to make those changes. Within Greater Glasgow and Clyde, as colleagues in the Parliament will be aware, we are currently proposing a series of changes to how we deliver acute services, which we believe will provide a safe and sustainable range of services while releasing a significant resource to enhance community-based services. That has proved and continues to prove as we go through the pre-engagement and consultation process challenging, because the public and many elected officials believe that hospital services and the status quo is indeed desirable. So there needs to be a coming together and understanding that we are all progressing change with a view to enhancing the population of Scotland in the medium to long term.
If I may?
Yes.
I can understand frustrations that people have about the speed of change. We visited Torbay when we were looking at the model for lead agency. 7 years in, they were just beginning to see some changes. We are 4.5 years down the route, and we are seeing changes in outcomes. And the focus was always about outcomes, and efficiencies would flow from that. But it is a major cultural change for staff, and not just some staff across our organisations, but all staff. And we have to take our staff with us and also our communities with us. So it's really important that we have a step change. We don't see it as a quick fix. And whatever we change, we get the chalks in behind and don't allow us to slip back and make sure that we sustain that change. Otherwise, we'll be having the same conversation 10 years down the line.
I'm actually quite concerned what I hear from Glasgow and Clyde, because it doesn't sound as if there's much impetus or buy-in. Maybe I'm wrong, but it doesn't sound like there's much impetus or buy-in on this integration process.
I would have to disagree with colleagues. I mean, Greater Glasgow and Clyde had the first joint community health and care partnerships back in 2006. It was the health board that led the whole idea of health and social care integration within the framework we had in 2006. We are one of the health boards who have successfully, with five of our six integration joint boards, agreed the totality of health and social care and criminal justice systems should be integrated into a successful organisation, because that's where we believe we can make the biggest impact. We have had a series of investments over the last 10 years, which has, working with colleagues in the government, seen significant investment in health and social care premises. We've opened six of the largest health and social care premises in Scotland in the last 3-4 years, and we are actively under construction for two, and we have business cases well advanced for a further three. So one of our big investments has been in creating health and social care infrastructure and integration. And indeed, as a health board, we have been successfully taking forward, firstly with our previous acute services strategy from 2002 to 2015, where we closed five major acute hospitals on the back of building new and improved and more efficient healthcare facilities. And as I made the opening comment, we are currently out to consultation, which will see more resources transferred, should these changes be agreed through due process, which will see more resources transferred from acute to health and social care partnerships.
Can you quantify what resources have already been made available to the IGBs?
Well, the IGBs, constructed within Glasgow, are now strategically responsible for the commissioning of something like 70% of the board's available allocations.
Would you say that the integrated budgets are being used efficiently to achieve the change that's required?
Well, in any organisation that spends in excess of £3.1 billion of taxpayers' money, there are always opportunities to improve and to learn. I think the various IGBs are at different stages in their journey. I think when my colleague Julie Murray appeared before you before, she intimated that our experience in East Renfrewshire has been as of a single integrated organisation going back 10 years with many examples of successful integration. If I look at our experience with Glasgow City, we've had two episodes of engagement with the city, firstly back in 2006 to 2011, when we had a sort of what was called a community health and care partnership. And then since 2015, we've had the shadow and now the formal IGB. And within the city, the impact on that integration has seen a significant improvement in delayed discharges. I mean, the city in its intermediary care and step down facilities has been very innovative in seeking to address what was historically one of the poorest delayed discharges performance in the Scottish Health Service.
Do you have a detailed plan to achieve your objectives?
Well, that we'd have to quantify what our various objectives are. At the present moment in time, the Health Board is having to deal with multiple aspects of services. But at the present moment in time, if you look at acute services, if you look at just Greater Glasgow and Clyde's activity, in the period 2012-13 through to 15-16, the last full set of figures, we have seen a reduction in emergency department attendances of just under 2%, which is a positive direction of providing the population with access to more appropriate and alternative facilities. However, despite that, over the same period, we've seen a rise in emergency admissions of some 9.6%, recognising, as the Auditor General's report published this morning said, the demographics of the population of Scotland, the ageing population, and the fact that, regrettably, with age, we make greater use of NHS services. So against that backdrop, we have continued to move resources, move the emphasis into primary and community services while dealing with the pressure on the acute services. And as I keep saying, we have proposals to further redesign acute services, the principal aim being to meet the healthcare needs in an acute environment for those patients that need to be there, and to create a more comprehensive range of community and primary care facilities for those patients who shouldn't be in the acute setting. Now that, as the Auditor General reports points out, both in part one and paragraph three of our report, and then later on in the report, that requires us to take quite bold decisions to move out of institutional care, release that money and put it into community and primary care alternatives.
Just turning to Highland there, just a brief question on that. Obviously, Highland's a wee bit further ahead, perhaps, than a lot of other areas. How are the lessons that you've learned on the way being shared with other organisations?
In many ways, I don't think they are. Obviously, we adopted the lead agency model for various reasons, and other boards have adopted the integrated board model, which has an entirely different governance process, decision-making process, financial model. And perhaps the integrated joint boards don't think there's a lot to learn from the lead agency. We do think there would be opportunities for sharing because, albeit the structures are important, this actually is about systems getting along together. And just picking up your first question, Mr. Beattie, I think that all we managed to do when we achieved integration in 2012 was bring two structures together. We didn't deliver integrated services. We didn't cut out duplication. We didn't put in preventative responses. It's the change that has been possible, given that structural change, that we've then had to work through. And whether you're an integrated joint board or whether you're a lead agency, you still have to put those process changes in place and you still have to bring people together. So, I mean, I would suggest there's lots of room for learning there, but I don't know if across Scotland there's been much sharing to date.
Is there any mechanism in place for this? Is anybody managing this?
Well, there are lots of different groupings. So social work directors come together, education directors come together, chief executives of NHS boards come together. We don't have a single forum where we discuss integration strategically as a collective. There are chief officers of the IJBs, but I don't think we're having that strategic discussion.
There's no formal process then for sharing the experiences that different areas have?
No.
That sounds unfortunate.
I think the biggest advantage is bringing the IJB chief officers together, and we are part of that. We have, although we don't fit, we don't have a chief officer in that same way, but we do input to that, and I think that's probably a forum that would be very useful for people to and welcomed by everyone to share.
I'm going to quickly interject and ask the same question of Glasgow and Clyde. Is there a forum for IJBs to share their experience if there's not in Highland? Is there in your area?
There is. The six chief officers meet regularly as a collective to look at the balance of locality need and planning for localities versus interacting with the board or with a population of 1.15 million to make sure that we don't have postcode prescribing and that there is a broad consistency of direction of travel, and as that interaction with the acute service is a single entity within Greater Glasgow and Clyde, so the six chief officers act as a collective, and we also have where systems where services are small and are provided across the board, these are embedded within the lead agency approach within one of the IJBs, so that a single chief officer would be, so for example, Keith Redpath is the chief officer for Western Bartonshire, is responsible for board-wide musculoskeletal services, physiotherapy in the community across all six partnerships. So they do meet. Also, the chief officers, as Jan has alluded to, meet regularly with colleagues in the Scottish Government Health Department, under the auspices of Jeff Huggins and Paul Gray, to talk about opportunities and learning, but also to learn of challenges and difficulties. So there is a number of fora within which IJBs can interact and learn. And obviously, Audit Scotland, in their role, along with other external agencies, bring forward examples of good practice, which is commended to the system.
Liam Kerr.
Thank you. Good morning. I'm interested in the people issues and particularly the role of the GPs and staff. The report talks about how GPs are central to developing new types of care. Pressure is building in general practice that we know about, and it suggests that new models of care are needed. So can you tell me, what are those new models of care precisely, and how do you see the development of GP recruitment and training being adapted to those new care models?
We acknowledge the role of GPs and all of our staff, and the developments around community care, developing a community service, has been central to GPs at the heart of that. So we have a number of different models, community huddles and virtual wards that involve GPs and the extended primary care team and community care team to ensure that we're proactively managing patients within the community, vulnerable patients particularly. Recruitment of GPs and consultants is of course a challenge for all of us across Scotland, and we're looking at different models of delivering what would be traditionally GP care. We have to realise that we can't be person dependent in terms of one profession. This is a multi-professional approach, and looking at where practitioners, community, enhanced practitioners in the community might be able to supplement GP practices. It's a huge issue for communities in Highland. People feel very attached to the GP and want a GP in their community. So we have to work very closely with the communities on how we take these models forward to ensure that they realise the safety element is still there. And that then might involve some kind of double running, but it means that we can demonstrate that this model is safe for them and they will receive a good quality service without the dependence on the GPs that perhaps they've had in the past.
I think it is widely accepted that GPs need to be fundamentally at the centre of developing a preventative culture and a community primary care based service to the population going forward. There are numerous pilot examples across Scotland going forward to look at how GPs would fulfil that role. I think Professor Sir Lewis Ritchie once described in relation to his report for the review of Out of Hours, He talks about the general practitioner of the future becoming the conductor of the orchestra and not the soloist, and it's all about multidisciplinary working. The government has supported an initiative to recruit a significant number of additional pharmacists, the aim being to try and embed pharmacy in the general practice, where those clusters of GPs come together to work in practices. There is a whole issue of the working, as some colleagues refer to it, as working at the top of your license, so that nurses, allied health professions, all do more to take on a workload as part of the primary community service alongside the general practitioner. So that there are a number of initiatives taking that forward. The impact that will have in GP recruitment should be positive. However, GP recruitment is a kind of multifactorial issue at the moment as to why we are encountering the position we find ourselves in at the moment. And we need to work effectively from the university going forward over the next, regrettably, 5 to 10 years, to put primary care front and centre from day one in the medical schools, and then much more right through the whole service as we go into the way forward. And I saw from reading previous evidence that there's this whole issue of the GP principal as a, dare I say, a private businessman model into the kind of section, the 17C contracts, where they're a salaried part of a team. And I think all of these things will have part of a debate as we go forward, and they will all impact, I think, on primary care differently in various health boards, whether that's to do with the remote and rural aspect, which again the government's been seeking to address with regard to increased recruitment and the premier they've attached to general practitioners who undertake training in a remote, for a remote and rural practice. Right the way through to recognising that we have a changing workforce. We have a significantly greater proportion of medical graduates who are female, who have different expectations of how they want to plan out their career. And we need to be aware of that, and we need to work with them to make sure that we create career opportunities within Scotland that fits with that changing demographic of our workforce.
I'll come back to that, if you don't mind, in a second. But, Jan Baird, you particularly point out that this is a challenge for all across Scotland. So are you aware, is there or is there going to be a nationally coordinated approach to recruitment and training at any point?
I'm not aware of that. I'm sure there needs to be, and I'm sure there will be. The models that Mr. Caldwell was referring to, particularly around salary GPs, are something that we've started and we're exploring, as well as our integrated teams and the GP having that single point of access. I think it's a very important point about training of GPs and expectations of GPs and other professions in the future. We still seem to be training people in silos. We don't work in silos anymore, and people are coming out and having to relearn how to work. And that's extremely challenging for a health board when we have to continually keep the system moving, because they do come out with expectations of working in primary care or secondary care, working in a particular way. And I really would welcome the opportunity to have some time with our universities and training colleges to encourage them to think about this legislation and the joint working that we expect in the future.
Well, I think that's an important point. And I mean, this committee knows I've got a thing about scenario planning and modelling and things. And so my penultimate question to you is what workforce planning is being carried out? Mr. Calderwood talks about a time horizon of 5 to 10 years. So why is that the time horizon? What scenario planning is being done? What modelling is being done to look at the needs of the future?
Well, I think there's two aspects to that. First of all, NHS Education Scotland is responsible for working with the government and with colleagues in higher education across the universities to look at the educational component and the intakes to the medical schools, nursing colleges, etc. So there is a central coordinated body within the NHS Scotland that creates that conduit to have the dialogue with the higher education sector and set out the needs. Also within the Scottish Government Health Directorate, Shelley Rogers, who's Director of HR and Organisational Development, has a significant role in coordinating the individual health boards' workforce planning scenarios, and making sure they're inverted commas future-proofed with regard to how we deal with succession planning and future recruitment. The point I made to set that in context, we have a shortage of GP principals. We have an inability today to fully recruit to the training opportunities that exist in Scotland. Those two issues will only be addressed in the medium to long term by making general practice much more attractive within the medical schools and therefore in the career development of medical graduates. The short-term issue of making Scotland more attractive to existing general practitioners is an issue that we need to look at in discussion, and that again is being addressed. The government's looking at the long term with regard to increasing the number of GP trainees and to create incentives to be the kind of general practitioners that Scotland, with its geographical constraints, needs to take into account. And also in the short term, the government's been taking forward pilots in various health economies across the system, whether it's the deep end practice initiative, which has been working in some of the areas of deprivation within Greater Glasgow, or other initiatives that other colleagues on the health boards are taking forward, that's again looking at working with the general practice population of today to make it more safe, sustainable and desirable. And I mentioned Professor Sir Lewis Richard. I mean, he was commissioned by the government to look at out of hours. Out of hours has been since 2004, when it was no longer contractually an obligation of general practitioners to look after their registered population list. We have seen out of hours as a fundamental part of general practice decline. If I use Greater Glasgow and Clyde, in 2004, we had some 650 plus general practitioners register to take shifts on in the out of hours service. That's down now to just over 300, despite the fact the number of general practitioners within Glasgow is probably, I don't have the exact numbers with me, but is higher. We have more general practitioners working within Glasgow tonight, but fewer of them will now register for the out of hours. That puts significant pressure on the out of hours service, and that's the point I was alluding to about having to understand the work-life balance and aspirations of our current and future workforce.
So we have a workforce plan that takes us to this short, longer, medium and longer term, looking up to 2035, actually, recently. But we're focused at the moment on testing new models. We think it's really important to test out new models and give support to the existing GPs, recognising the retirement rate that's coming towards us, but building the flexibility of the roles, giving more support to those GPs. And we have a specific out-of-hours, specific redesign, looking at how we deliver out-of-hours differently. And all of that work is in the communities, driven in the communities, but also with colleagues and partners in Scottish Ambulance Service, for example.
Final point, the report makes a number of recommendations around the 2020 vision and suggests that by the end of 2016, there should be a clear framework, including around predictions of supply and demand with recruitment and training plans. So I just wondered, we're now obviously at the end of October, have the Scottish Government provided that clear framework of how it expects the NHS boards, councils, integration authorities to achieve the 2020 vision?
I don't have specific information on that, I'm afraid. I know that we are working to the 2020 vision and our own local plans reflect that. I would have to speak to colleagues to get you information from our HR colleagues, if that's helpful.
I think from that particular question, I'd make reference to 2 points. I already alluded to the fact that Shelley Rogers is coordinating, bringing together all of the health board's workforce plans into a coherent whole that will look at the needs for Scotland over agreed time horizons going forward. And I think when Paul Gray gave evidence to the committee, he alluded to the fact that the government has a commitment to publish that by the end of the year. And to the best of my knowledge, that's where all the organisations are working towards that position.
Okay, Monica Lennon.
Thank you, good morning. In the Audit Scotland report, Changing Models of Health and Social Care, we see that councils and NHS boards, you know, in general, are finding it difficult to agree budgets. for the new integration authorities. I wonder if you can say if that reflects your experience in Greater Glasgow and Clyde and Highland.
From a Greater Glasgow and Clyde perspective, no, I think all six IGBs recognised the difficulty we had in the first year because there's a significant gap in the timing between the approval of the draft finance bill and the ultimate allocations to health boards, which have traditionally been from a draft finance bill towards the end of September, early October, through to Parliament approving that in early to mid-February. Health boards don't get definitive allocations until after that process. So normally, my allocation letter from Paul Gray as Director General would be early March. This year, in 16-17, that process was extended because of other issues. So it was mid to late May before the health board was in final receipt of its total allocations and therefore gross income for 16-17. Throughout that process, the chief financial officers, along with the chief officers of the IGBs, worked collectively with the board's executives to deal with the scenario planning that underpins utilising those resources to meet the needs of the population. I think if you expressed the question of would people have welcomed more funding to deal with the challenges they were being confronted with, the answer would be undoubtedly yes. All of my colleagues would welcome more resources to deal with the challenges. But the process this year is, I think, that there was full transparency throughout the process. So although there was a greater certainty in the period between October and then councils taking definitive decisions at their meetings in early February, there was the same transparency of risk in the health board position. So we made clear, and chief financial officers were involved with Mark and his colleagues, in looking at the 15-16 expenditure that the board had for all services that were now embedded. So they saw the rollover of those allocations. They saw the uplift the health board had received. They saw the government priorities. And then we debated how you would use the resources to deal with the inflationary pressures and the government priorities for 16-17, which then resulted in a service profile that is underpinned by that financial resource.
So can you just explain to me how long it took to set the budget and when the budget was set?
The final budget to the IGBs was in writing, set at the end of June after the board's LDP and discussions with the government were concluded, and the board's annual accounts for 15-16 and the rollover consequences of that were agreed with our external auditors, which in our case is Audit Scotland.
In terms of the Highland Partnership, is it difficult? Absolutely. It's probably the thing that is the most difficult. Have we managed to do it? Yes, we have managed to do it. It's difficult for the reasons that Mr. Calderwood has said. We've got two separate channels of funding that have to be brought together. Mr. Calderwood's talked about the timescales. It's not helped by the fact that we have single year budget setting. Highland Council did give NHS Highland a 3-year financial commitment, and in this year we weren't able to honour that because of the significantly different grant settlement there was for this year that we only understood very late on. It's clearly difficult when there are either flat or reducing budgets at a time of increasing and significant demand. And it's also difficult when the channels of funding have to be spread more widely. So for the council, the channel that the council gets has to fund adult social care, but it also has to fund filling potholes. It also has to fund the running of schools. And therefore, politicians have got very difficult decisions to make. So all of that is very challenging. We've managed to do it in part because we have structures, but in large part because we have relationships and you work through it, and ultimately because the greater imperative is to achieve that and to keep going, because you can only deliver an integrated service if you do resolve that challenge. And probably it is that final overriding issue that hangs in there. When you walk away at 7 o'clock at night, still not having quite sorted it out. You don't say, well, we're just going to stop, we're going to chuck it. You say, no, we have to get through this, and you just keep working at it. And Highland Council included in its February budget meeting what the allocation would be to NHS Highland, and NHS Highland knew in advance of February what that was likely to be. But it wasn't easy to get there, and it's not going to be easy to get there this year either.
Thank you for your answer. I appreciate you being very open there about the difficult challenges. So am I right that in both cases you've been able to set your budget for this year, but do you have a budget for next year or an indicative budget?
In Highland, we are working on a scenario. We are scenario planning. But that is based on assumptions about what the council's grant settlement might be, and it's based on assumptions about what the NHS might get. Now, we won't know till December whether that is true. Those assumptions will be discussed, and at various levels in the two organisations, senior officer level and elected member level, we'll talk those through. But we won't actually know till December whether how much money we will have in both organisations, and it won't be till December that we'll be able to actually conclude those discussions in advance of a February budget for the council.
Similar situation with Glasgow. We have a budget for 16-17. We're coming to the mid-year point that we're performing some detailed review of that, and that is proving quite challenging. So we are not out the woods yet for 16-17. Albeit we have a budget, it has a number of risks in it. In terms of 17-18, as all my colleagues have alluded to, we did attempt to try to bring that planning process forward to align much more with local authorities, but we still have some way to go with that. We at NHS Glasgow certainly plan to issue to our IGBs some indicative numbers within the next 10 days to 2 weeks. They will obviously be heavily caveated depending on a number of different factors, the outturn from 16-17, the budget that will come in the middle of December. So we are striving to try to get to a much more aligned process, but it does have its difficulties.
Can I just add to that we all strive to have a longer plan, a three-year plan, so that we can get on with the business. This takes up a huge amount of energy and time of officers across the council and in the NHS debating and deciding, and it's a very important decision, but actually it's taking a lot of time to do it every year. And if we could get to a stage where we could agree a three-year plan and be clear about what our budgets are going to be and let us get on with it, that would actually be welcomed.
Bill made a point about the late nights, and I'm sure you're all working very hard and against the clock, but when you're working those long hours and you're just trying to get this all signed off for the year, when you look at the scale of transformational change that this is all trying to achieve, you know, do you feel at all optimistic that these outcomes can be delivered when you're talking about the scale of challenges that you're facing?
Absolutely. I mean, although there's still that challenge, I mean, we often refer, Jan and I were meeting with councillors end of last week, and we tell the story that, you know, Jan and I used to meet at breakfast, we used to meet at lunch, and then we used to shout at each other at tea time every single day to try and run joined up services. And joined up services are better than silo working, but they're very bureaucratic, they're very laborious, and in terms of bureaucracy and hassle, it's a hell of a lot of work. Having an integrated arrangement where you just let one system get on and do it is much easier. But there is still hassle and there's still bureaucracy, and the budget setting is one of the, well, it is the greatest challenge.
But we've got to make it work because there is no alternative. We can't continue to do what we've done in the past. We have to make it work. And when we launched integration in 2012, the plan was a joint board and joint council and complete sign up to it. Everyone agreed it was about making things better for the people of Highland, and that's what we have to hold on to.
I think I have to say that the health social care integration is a very needed way to address the challenges of the Scottish population going forward, and therefore as a structural change, bringing together health and social care and looking to plan them from a bottom-up locality basis is absolutely the right building block going forward. What we have to do is be bold in that ambition and understand that we are going to have to take quite sizable changes in the way that we meet the population's needs. If I could reference this to the past, I mean, the last time we embarked on anything probably this ambitious was in the early 90s, when in mental health and learning disabilities we all agreed that large hospital institutions where people spent inordinate lengths of time, years, and in the case of learning disabilities, lifetimes, in institutional care was undoubtedly wrong. We were more able in those days to create what was referred to as bridging finance, where we were able to roll a programme out across Scotland using a rolling programme of bridging finance to create the alternative community facilities, and then with the new facilities in place, run down and ultimately close these mental health institutions and learning disabilities. And to put that in context, in a period of less than 20 years, just within Greater Glasgow and Clyde, we have gone from almost 3,000 learning disability beds now to less than a few hundred. We've gone from something that would have been in the region of 5,000 to 6,000 mental health beds down to literally 1,100, 1,200. And the service is significantly better, with it all being community-based, all about intervention, all about prevention. That is an indication of what you can do. We have to achieve the same effects in a more constrained financial environment, but it is about making these bold changes into community and prevention and taking out the costs from the institutions. And that, I have to say, across the piece, is going to be what will dictate the pace of this. It's when you can bring clinicians across the piece together to say that they genuinely believe that the alternative is better, we have to be able to make that resource switch. And therefore, we have to be bold in switching off what has been the custom and practice.
Thank you. Robert, earlier on, you said, I think it was about emergency admissions, it was almost a 10% rise. I think that was from the period 12-13 to 15-16. I wonder if you can say in that context how pressures on acute budgets are affecting this shift in resource that is needed.
Well, I think that is the rate limiting factor. I mean, at the present moment in time in this financial year 16-17, our acute services are overspending against the budget's allocated, and that's brought about by two principal reasons. One, the demand is changing. Now, in some cases, that might not be the numerical demand. It's the acuity of the patients coming into the system. It's the ability we have to treat the patients differently, more aggressively, with changes that have been made within the Scottish Health Service, changes that have been made with regard to access to end-of-life drugs. These are all very important changes to individual clinical groups, but cumulatively, they have been behind, as Audit Scotland has alluded to in its report this morning, a 10% year-on-year rise in prescribing costs. Because although an element of that is the volume going up, a large element of that is we are now prescribing very, very expensive sort of what we would refer to as third and fourth line treatments to patient populations. So the acute sector is one of these conundrums. If I was to set it down in Glasgow, we use less occupied bed days. I mean, so if we've got patients in hospitals for less, if I take the same period, 12-13 to 15-16, we've reduced the bed days that we use for that, right? Although the population of admissions is rising, they're in hospital cumulatively 6% less days compared to the period. So that's clinical teams interacting with the patients, making use of faster access to diagnosis, making greater use of interaction with social care colleagues for onward movement into community and ultimately back to their own home. So that's at one level a success story. But the cost of that is significantly higher than it was in 12-13. So despite the successes, we still have cost pressures. So in acute, we need to continue to redesign acute services to strive to get the greatest efficiency. And there are many success stories over the years. The problem is we now have to take stock of where we are now in 2016. The previous success stories have only got us to where we are today, which is close to but not necessarily in balance.
Increase in emergency admissions, that's not success, is it?
Well, what I'm saying is we can handle that 10% increase in admissions in the expectation it will go down, but we can handle it at the moment in a more efficient way. You know, what I'm saying at the moment is clinically, the clinical community in Scotland would sign up to handling the current demand in a different way within acute services, which would have the impact of improving efficiency, improving care for patients, but it would be not on the basis of how we do it tonight. It would be using our premises, our staff differently.
Is that overspend?
For Glasgow this year? Well, as an accountable officer, I'm not allowed to overspend. So the official answer, just because my colleagues don't call it behind me, the official answer is I will not overspend at the 31st of March. The pressure at the moment is we are...
You mentioned an overspend.
Yes, we are currently, as we sit today, at month six, the acute division is about £9 million overspent.
Examples in terms of Highland, similar pressures. I think we all feel that with the demographic. We've focused and been able to do so because of our lead agency model on improving the community services and enabling better choice for GPs or integrated teams when it comes to decision about to admit or not to admit. And that involves anticipated care planning, involves virtual wards where consultants from the hospital and GPs and community teams plan together and around the vulnerable clients and patients they have in the community to try and make sure measures in place to prevent admission. And having those choices for GPs has made a big difference. We now have no patients waiting coming out of hospital for care at home because we've been able to work with our independent sector, improve the way we deliver care at home, and have patients moving more quickly through the hospital for care at home. It's not at all a good news story, but for care at home, that is a good news story. And that also helps a reactive service that helps put in that emergency or crisis care rather than somebody ending up in hospital, which is part of the problem, really.
Thank you, Jen. Can I just ask, what are your long-term plans for transferring resources from the acute sector into the community?
Well, we, as I say, we're developing our teams in the community to work differently, quite differently, and to work with our colleagues in acute care quite differently. We've seen quite a significant shift over the years since we integrated. We've put a considerable amount of money into community care. The difficulty, I guess, for colleagues sometimes is to say, well, where's the money coming out of the acute sector? But of course, it's not a level playing field, so we still have an increasing demand. And as Mr. Calderwood said, we have expectations around new medications, new interventions. So there's still a huge demand on the acute sector. But we have shifted. So in 11-12, we had a £70 million gap between our expenditure in community-based care and institutional-based care. And in 2014-15, that was reduced to £26 million. So we're seeing that actually we're investing in our communities, keeping people in the community and preventing those hospital admissions unless they're absolutely essential. And that makes sure that the hospitals, again, Mr. Calderwood referred to people working to the top of the licence, hospitals are actually treating people who need to be there and have that level of care.
Thank you. Just one final point, convener. I think someone made the point, I think it may have been Robert earlier, about some resistance to change from perhaps local politicians, people in the community. Can I ask both of you, you know, what steps you're taking to engage with patients and communities to bring people on this journey with you?
We are engaged on a whole range of initiatives. The IGBs, through their public engagement responsibilities and their patient panels, are actively engaged on an ongoing, you know, dare I say, a weekly basis through that process, and that's to be a locality, you know, locality clusters built up. There is a significant engagement with the staff, be it through primary care, community staff about alternative models, and within the acute sector, within the acute staff about opportunities. We provide regular interaction with our elected colleagues through the IGBs in relation to councillors and directly with MSPs, either on a newsletter basis or in an individual request for information where we meet. All changes that the board is proposing are signalled in our annual planning round of future changes, and depending on the changes, there is a comprehensive range of engagement and then formal consultation that has to take place with the service users, with the communities, and again through that process with the elected officials, all of which then results in final papers and recommendations coming back to the board, and in some instances the board then makes recommendations to the Cabinet Secretary.
On a personal basis, the vast majority of us, for ourselves and our families, would prefer community-based solutions. You know, we often say that people would much rather stay at home than go into a care home. You'd much rather be supported within the community than be admitted into hospital. But having said that, there's no doubt a challenge when it comes to reducing the number of beds or even closing a ward or closing a hospital in your particular community. That does create a response. And that's something we need to work through. We do that in a range of ways. We do endeavour to engage community groups, locally based organisations, patient service user representatives in some of those change processes. We have a range of improvement groups and we have broad stakeholder involvement in those. I think also, though, one of our success stories has been that when we initiated integration, we developed a range of what at the time we called district partnerships. They were locality planning groups, and we endeavoured to get community organisations based in those to talk the change through in those processes. That hasn't been an easy journey. The notion of locality planning groups was included in the joint bodies, public bodies bill. And we obviously now have the Community Empowerment Act, and we're transforming our district partnerships into local community partnerships. We really do think that if you start to engage with people around the table over a cup of coffee, talking about these things, you can actually change the way of thinking about it, and we have some evidence of that. That doesn't mean that we still have major challenges with communities who see significant changes in the local infrastructure as being very worrying and very troubling. And we always have a number of examples of those. When you have that feeling, it's difficult to recover the ground. It's difficult to get back to basics. It does need a lot of dialogue. Wherever possible, it's best to start with that dialogue in the first place. Not come to people with a plan, but talk about developing the plan around the table with people. But it is a long road.
Thank you. Bill Alexander, I think you said in an earlier response to Monica Lennon that integration makes things easier, but two separate budgets and budget agreement doesn't. Are you suggesting that integration needs to go further?
Well, I mean, the integration journey has been an interesting one, hasn't it? I mean, through the noughties, the 2000s, we all talked about getting to an integrated destination and when would this happen and what might it look like. I don't think any of us believe that we're at the end point just yet. We're now well down the road. Unfortunately, no one ever gave us a map, so we don't know where the next turning might be. We've got a compass, and I think we're all walking in a particular direction. But clearly, there's a number of continuing developments. You know, there's discussion around NHS governance, there's discussion around education governance, there's discussion around funding arrangements, there's discussion about the role of local government. Now, all of this is going to play into this. There's discussion about local versus central. All of that will play into this. I mean, we believe that we are now in a place where we can consolidate, where we can sustain, and we can continue to move forward. But I have to say that discussions about regionalisation, discussions about changes to local governance, that all, you know, is troubling and unsettling. And I don't think any of us think that we're at the final destination point. I mean, we do a lot of work in the north with our island colleagues, and they certainly have aspirations towards a single public agency. They think that a single funding stream will be more helpful to them than two funding streams. That's more difficult to achieve elsewhere, but I don't think any of us think we're at an end point.
Does there need to be better governance around IJBs?
Well, it's not for us to comment on IJB governance. I mean, we would suggest that the governance model we have has got clearer roles and clearer accountability. I would suggest it's got clearer roles for elected members because the elected members act as elected members. When they are scrutinising the delivery of adult social care by NHS Highland, they are doing that as the council. There are fewer of them, and that has been a challenge and probably a challenge we underestimated when we moved towards integration. That when you move towards an integrated model, yes, you are enlarging the governance because you have governance over a larger remit, but also you're reducing it because you are sharing it out more broadly. And therefore, instead of, for example, I would work with 22 members at a committee, we have 11 members who now scrutinise the delivery of NHS Highland's delivery of adult social care. But they do act as elected members scrutinising the delivery. And I think they're confident to act as elected members. I'm not quite sure what the elected members on an IJB think the role is and whether that's worked through. But we have gone through different iterations of governance. We started off with a model in 2012, and we've just changed that this year, and we'll continue to review that to try and get that quite right.
You said that no one ever gave you a map for this. Do you think there is a need across the country, across Scotland, for clearer targets, benchmarks, best practice, sharing for integration at national level?
We welcome any strategic discussion like that. And I said earlier, there are lots of different groups meeting in different places. You know, I was with the Association of Directors of Education 2 weeks ago talking about integration. I'll be with Chief Social Officers next week talking about integration. There'll be another meeting with Chief Officers of IJBs talking about integration. I just think it would be good if we had an overall structure talking about integration. I mean, we'd also make the point, when we integrated in 2012, we did it for Highland. I remember Mr. Neil on many platforms in 2011 talking about developing, thinking about integration on the back of what was starting to happen in Scotland. But we did it for Highland. We didn't do it as part of a national initiative, and we worked out our model for Highland. It would have been great to have had a map which we could have then Highlandized in order to get to where we wanted to get to.
I think in terms of support, the shift, the significant shift, which is difficult for staff, difficult for evidencing and difficult for government, is how you evidence outcomes. We're still asked information about how many social workers we have or how many nurses we have, which actually means nothing if they're all not good at their job. So it's how we actually make sure that the indicators and the targets we've got reflect the outcomes we're trying to achieve. Now, that's very difficult to do, and government have been working with that and helping us, and we've just redesigned our performance management process and our balanced scorecard to try and reflect a link right back to the health and wellbeing outcomes, because that's what we all aspire to deliver. But it's actually very difficult to decide, is integration wholly attributable here, or is it a contribution? Where does all the other things that we do, and undoubtedly all the other things together, make up the jigsaw that then achieves the outcomes? But actually then taking them apart and trying to have indicators or targets against each of them is problematic and difficult to evidence.
Bob Calder, would you agree there needs to be a map or an overall structure?
I think there needs to be a clear understanding of direction of travel, and potentially some vision of some stations we'll pass through on that journey. There has to be the opportunity for local innovation. Well, there'll be a combination of that. I think the government has a significant role in setting the direction of travel for the health and social care services in Scotland as part of the public sector landscape. I think also the bottom-up innovation that is a kind of core principle of the design of the IJB shouldn't be lost. And I think although we have to watch that we don't have 57 varieties of everything, because there is an issue of equity for the Scottish people, we shouldn't actually have a single model that fits. And if I look at Glasgow and Clyne, I look at Highland, we have two different models. Now, where we are with our six IJBs is that we have amicably with council colleagues created the governance structure, created the service delivery organisation, and albeit in their first year, I've had no instances reported back to me or my fellow local authority chief executives. I've had no instances reported back where the IJB as a governance body has not collectively come to, in fact, I think I can only think of, I've only had one debate reported to me on one IJB where it went to vote. In all other instances, the policies and the way forward has been jointly agreed. Going back to your first question, are we an end point? No, I think the current legislation, the current organisational construct will mature. And I think some of the duplication between the parent bodies and the IJB will mature and potentially develop over time, which may require a tweaking to the regulation. But, you know, we need to learn.
An end point wasn't my question. It was, do we need more guidance on how to get to that end point?
Well, as I say, I think we need to be quite clear collectively where we're going, so that each of the IJBs and their respective parent bodies can demonstrate that they're on a progression to that point.
Thank you. Alex Neil.
Can I just go back to budgets? Because obviously money is absolutely vital to the whole thing. Are we now at the stage where, given what you've said, and I appreciate what you're saying about the time and the effort and the managerial time and the uncertainty going into the negotiations in 31 different partnerships across the country, has the time now come for the Scottish Government itself to change the way in which it allocates money and for it to take the IGBs and allocate each IGB a budget so that the social work element, the social care element, which currently is in the local government settlement, and the health element, which is currently part of the health budget, come together and we have a national level, if you like, an IGB support budget that's then allocated to the 31 IGBs, so that means you don't have all this negotiation and all the difficulties. It's allocated at a national level, and presumably also, given that we are now moving back into a comprehensive spending review over a three-year period, based on particularly what Jan said, clearly the certainty of knowing in the next 3 years the minimum of money that you're going to get would be extremely helpful as well. But it seems to me that we're almost at the stage where we should be allocating directly the IGB budget, which would take all of this nonsense out of the system.
I think that would be a debate for Parliament. I think looking at Paul Gray's evidence to the committee at the moment, the Cabinet Secretary for Finance brings forward the Finance Bill, Parliament debate the utilisation of that gross resource, and then it's allocated to the various public sector priorities. Within health, there is then under the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care, there is a debate about how that has worked. And then once that allocation to territorial boards is agreed, it is distributed under the NRAC formula, and again, you know, a lot is made of that formula. Those of us that are losing obviously always have views about whether the formula is really reflective of our circumstances. It is always thus, but it is a recognised formula. And then it comes to the Health Board. The Health Board, I can only speak for Great Glasgow and Clyde, but the Health Board then have cognizance of the NRAC formula, so that if we get a gross allocation for a 1.15 million population based on these characteristics, we can then subdivide that down to the six IGBs using the same formula. So there is an element to try and be transparent all of the way through from the Parliament to the IGBs. To link to your second question, it's a personal comment I have to make this. I don't think at the moment the current construct of the IGBs with their strategic commissioning role for acute services can work in the model where all of the resources not in. I was going to say the fudge, but the grey area in the strategic commissioning of unscheduled care in an acute setting, with the Health Board in its current construct being responsible for acute care and the balance of acute care, which is the semi-elective, the elective care and the regional and tertiary model, that would be, I think, very challenging for Parliament to work all of that out and then come to a decision between that element is for primary, community, unscheduled care, and therefore what's left is for the rest. So I think you would have to work through that governance bit. But if you were to look at true health and social care in primary and community settings, taking into account locality needs, then you would have to work through that as a formula.
Is that not because you're a joint board or six joint boards, Robert, whereas Highland is one? Now, if we take the Highland model, would that work with the Highland model?
Well, I'll just offer you one comment, which is, of course, the Highland is always single. It isn't actually single from a health social care perspective, because the Highland Butte IGB gets about 80% of its acute care from Greater Glasgow and Clyde, simply because of the geography and the flows. If you look at the six or seven, I think it's six, health boards that are coterminous with their local authority and therefore have a single IGB, then absolutely, if you put the totality of the funding in, you could work from a parliamentary level down and look at the totality. What that suggests, and again, I stress this as a personal thing, what that stresses is you don't need three legal entities to do that, if that's the model you choose. All right? If you look at Greater Glasgow Clyde's a more, if you like, extreme example where we provide acute care for in essence 10 IGB, six are coterminous with our boundaries, but because of flows, we deal with Argyll and Bute, we deal with South Lanarkshire, we deal with North Ayrshire because of the geographical flows into our basic acute services. That model would be highly challenging to collect almost in a purchaser provider old speak way of collecting money from these bodies to then arrive at a budget to then design the acute service that the board, if it existed, would be responsible for commissioning. So I think the debate has merit in it, but it would have to be part of a journey. The current construct couldn't switch to that, in my opinion, overnight.
I think we would really welcome discussion and Scottish Government reconsidering this, given the issues that we've raised today about timing and the desire and aspiration we still have to lose the identity of the pound, which of course was in the legislation and guidance as well, the aspiration to move to that health and social care pound all in one. It also, the other challenge of course is the local authorities have in terms of the other aspects of their budgets and where the cuts fall. Some areas of local authority budgets seem to be protected. Are we going to be looking at adult social care in the future being protected, given the demographic, given the change that we need to make? Currently, if there are a number of services within councils that are protected, then the cut falls higher across other services, and adult social care sits within that. So elected members have got very difficult decisions to make, and so we would welcome Parliament thinking differently about allocations of funding.
I think on the back of what Jan is saying there, that elected members in Highland would certainly want me to say that we need to think about local democracy and the role of the elected member within their community to decide on local priorities, and they certainly wouldn't want that to be lost.
Let me rephrase the question then, without saying that is necessarily the answer in terms of a straightforward budget allocation from the Scottish Government to each IGB. From certainly what the three of you have said, first of all, from what Robert said, it's actually quite a complicated relationship. It's quite a complex relationship as things stand, particularly obviously in Glasgow, when you're dealing with the boards dealing with six IGBs, not to mention what you do with Ayrshire and all the other bits and pieces. Let me rephrase the question. Is it time, given what you've said about the frustrations of the current way in which the monies are allocated, is it time for the government now to be looking at doing that in a better way without defining here what that better way is? Because I think, because certainly, you know, the army of finance people, with all due respect, the army of finance people we have, you know, with all the different finance departments in the health service and in the local authority sector, is a use of resources that is not really probably the best use of resource in terms of employing a lot of accountants when we need the money to go into the actual services for patients. So is there agreement between both of you, and it's very different systems operating in the Highland and in Glasgow, but is there agreement that we need, now is the time to start looking at this to see if it can be simplified and made more straightforward, while at the same time obviously ensuring that resources are allocated on the basis of need?
I think there is merit in continuing the dialogue to see how, firstly, we can move to that longer time horizon of setting a certainty of budget over the 3-year period that we aspire to, so that the respective organisations' planning can be presented to the communities, to the public, with that certainty of direction of travel and consequence and movement of resource. I think there is an element of duplication in the current system, and it would be worthy of review after a period of time to see whether that duplication can and will be eradicated just by relationships, as Bill has alluded to, or whether there is the opportunity to streamline the thing. But I come back to the point that I think we've all made. Health and social care integration, leaving to one side the governance model, is undoubtedly the only way we can address the demographics and the needs of the population in Scotland going forward, because they have absolute, almost linear consequences between each other. They have to work in partnership. We all are aware of stories of families interacting with multiple professionals who are capable individually of doing more. We need to enable that. You know, we refer to things like the one-stop phone call, the GP phones a certain point to get the range of services that family need, not 14 phone calls. The whole idea of a district nurse coming into a family should be able to commission the social care, the elements that the family need. There shouldn't need to be a referral to another professional to come in. So I think we are all agreed that the direction is going. We're all agreed that where we're going is the right way.
Yeah. Can I ask you, Bob, particularly because obviously you're the chief executive with long experience in the NHS, but clearly there's a debate going on about the number of territorial health boards we have. We've got 14 territorial health boards, and certainly there is a view, certainly in some of the other parties have expressed this officially, that we should go back to the days when there were three strategic health boards allocating resources to the various bits of the health service. Would it make life easier? I mean, the very good example you gave of the complexity that Greater Glasgow and Clyde has, because even though you're Greater Glasgow and Clyde, you know, I think I'm right in saying something like 40% of all healthcare funded through the health service in Scotland is funded in one way or another through Greater Glasgow and Clyde Health Board. Would it make sense now to, in looking at the conversation about the allocation of resources and making life easier for everybody, per the evidence we've heard this morning, to be simultaneously talking about the rationalisation of the number of health boards? Would it make life easier?
I'm not sure where Mr. Neil keeps throwing me these questions. Appearance for the committee will be my infamous appearance for the committee.
Well, I'm just about to say, as you're about to retire, you don't need to stick to the party
well,
line.
Well, there's also that as well, of course. But what I can say to you is when I joined the National Health Service, there were four regional health boards for Scotland, and their specific responsibilities was to plan for acute services. The interaction with the local authorities around public health and community aspects was clearer, so that there is precedence in that. We're not reinventing something. You know, we're not inventing something that's never been tried. Where we are at the moment, if you look at the IGBs as being strategic entities that can develop and need to develop using that resource, there's an overlap in that role with the current health boards, which needs to be reviewed over time. I think if you look at Angus Cameron's National Clinical Strategy, which the government have adopted, it talks much more about planning for populations, removing artificial boundaries. And if you look at that and you look at the challenges we have in acute services, there is no doubt that for acute services and the elements of specialist services in mental health, etc., you need bigger populations than the 31 IGBs have to make those strategic planning decisions. When you look at capital investment in a country like Scotland, you can't look at capital investment times 31. You need to look at a much more strategic map of Scotland. So that there are issues, in my opinion, that taking certain aspects of responsibilities for bigger populations. Now, whether you achieve that in a kind of codifying of health board's responsibilities to act collegiately through a regional overarching network, or whether you take the view that you want to look at the public sector landscape in Scotland and come up with a more streamlined version, I think there's much to commend that discussion.
Significant debate, and as Mr. Caldwell alluded, it would be difficult to get into some of the more sensitive areas, but can I suggest that there are some things that are best done at a very local community level. There are some things best done at an authority-like level. That's not saying the current authority boundaries we have are perfect, but there are good things done at that level. And there are some things that should be done at a regional level. But our experience would suggest that transformational change needs to be done at a localish level. And certainly the coterminosity of the Highland Council area with NHS Highland, allowing the... allowing the chair of the board to meet regularly with the council leader, allowing the two chief executives to meet regularly, allowing senior officers to meet regularly, that has provided a platform for transformational change. I find it difficult to conceive how that transformational change would be achieved in Portree or Inverness or Dingwall if the decision making was in Aberdeen or Dundee.
Can I just go back to, because there was an underlying theme, I think, in your earlier evidence as well, and that is, and I think it referred to particularly an answer to Colin previously, that there seems to be a bit of a vacuum in terms of the need for a more, if you like, call it business plan nationally, for not just for integration, but for acute services and so on. I mean, if you look at NHS England, for example, they don't just have a vision and a strategy. They actually have, at national level, a business plan, which actually says, this is where we're going to shift resources from, where we're going to shift them into, and it's a much more detailed approach, bringing together into one document workforce planning, financial allocations, the strategy for shifting resources from the acute sector to primary and to the community, and so on and so forth. Now, I tried to initiate that when I was the Health Secretary. I wouldn't go into any other detail on that. It wouldn't be right to do so, but it seems to me that we're operating without that kind of national plan that many other parts of the United Kingdom have. Secondly, as you've already referred to, your allocation, financial allocations are on a year-to-year basis. You know, you've got operating a budget, in Glasgow's case, of around $3 billion a year. You don't get the allocation letter to about 28 days before the start of the new financial year. You don't have yourselves a detailed business plan for the next 3 or 5 years because you don't know how much money you've got for a start. So it seems to me that there's quite a lot of improvements the Scottish Government can make to the kind of framework within which you're operating to help you guys do your job. And, you know, we're back on to, and we haven't been for a while, on a 3-year comprehensive spending review so that we know as a Scottish Government what our allocation is going to be. Now, that might change in the autumn statement, but at the moment, we know what the allocation is going to be for next year, the year after, and the year after that. If we could pass on that kind of degree of planning, would that not help you guys so that at least you could plan 3 years in advance instead of, you know, getting 28 days notice of what next year's budget's going to be?
Without a doubt, I think the more we're able to plan long term, the better, and the more the certainty we have around funding and everything else. We do lots of needs assessment and assessment of demographics locally, so we know what the challenges are going to be going forward. We know about the changes we have to make. I shy away from a plethora of plans. I think we've been there in the past. It's certainly helpful.
Is that not the problem, Jan? There is a plethora. And the whole point of one national plan is it would be one document covering all these things. Because one of the things, the frustrations I felt when I was Health Secretary is, you know, I got a workforce plan, you get different types of workforce plans, you get local workforce plans, you get, you know, workforce plans for different sectors within the National Health Service. Now, I know under Shirley Rogers that's changing and it's a national workforce plan, but the workforce plan is meaningless unless it's put in the wider context of the wider business plan. And that was my frustration. So many plans when one would do.
And I understand that. That's, we can see they're heading in that direction. I think how we look at it locally is that particularly around the community planning, community empowerment, again, requests for locality plans. We've got two sets of legislation, community empowerment and public bodies, both requiring plans. We're quite clear that those plans are worked up from a community basis. It's one plan that just feeds into the two sets of legislation, and we don't intend to produce different plans. I think from government point of view, we certainly welcome the vision. We certainly welcome the expectation in terms of outcomes. But I think delivery and improvement has to be at a local level. We have to be responsible for saying how we will deliver that, because that will be completely different in Highland as it is to in Glasgow, and so it should be.
Yeah.
But if we're all focused on the same outcomes, and you're clear about what outcomes are expected, and I go back to the point of how do we evidence that effectively, then I think that gives us all the route map that we actually need to say, this is the way we're going, whether it's 2020 or 2035, how are we going to get there? And here is the funding that will allow you to make those longer term, because this is not a quick fix. I said that in my opening statement. It does take time, but we're spending an awful lot of time refreshing plans every year and waiting to see what allocations are.
Okay. Yeah, I think there's much to commend the debate. I would give sort of two sort of practical examples. In 2002, after a 2-year period of engagement with the population, the then Greater Glasgow Health Board published an acute services strategy, which attracted much comment and debate, but ultimately, after agreement with the Parliament on the way forward, that gave us a route map, which then resulted in 2015 as us reaching the end of that particular exercise and opening the Queen Elizabeth University Hospital campus. It allowed us to align capital and resources to that journey. It tweaked, as it inevitably would over such a length of period, with debates carrying on through 2004, 2006, as changes came, we debated them. But we had a direction of travel, we were able to align all our resources. Similarly, within Greater Glasgow and now Greater Glasgow and Clyde, we've had the same debate with the public about mental health and learning disabilities, which talks about the end point, the balance between institutional care, local care, crisis intervention, and the skills needed. And again, on the basis of publishing that, we've had a 5-year certainty that we need this amount of capital, or we need this amount of resource in the sense of skills. And we've been able to move forward in that direction because we've been very clear what the status quo was and what the end point was. Greater Glasgow and Clyde will, in my opinion, along with every other health board, need to be very clear early in the new year what their next roadmap is. You know, where do they expect to be in 2021 and in 2025? And the challenge will be how we engage collectively within our individual responsibilities and with the communities about describing what people find as challenging, which is not welcoming the status quo, but promising something different, which people have concerns about because they know what they've got. They're never always certain about what we are saying the future should look like. Now, and I think that's where we are. We in Greater Glasgow and Clyde, and I'm from talking to my colleagues and other health boards, I think they're in the same place. We need to engage with the community about this very clear vision of we're here, we're going there, and then after debate and agreement, we can then say we're clear where we're going. So when we put forward resource utilisation proposals, they're consistent with the direction of travel. They are not opportunistic. You know, they're not just what today looks like.
Let me just say, we're running short of time. If members could keep their... I've still got a couple of members to bring in. A little bit shorter, a little bit shorter answers would be much appreciated. Kay. Thank you.
Because we could go on and debate that for ad infinitum. But my final question is, clearly we've got Highland with one model, we've got the rest of the country basically with the other model. And I know it's early days, not so much in terms of Highland, because you've been going longer, but in terms of the statutory way in which this has been set up, it's early days for the joint boards. But even anecdotally, is there any evidence that one model is performing better than the other?
I'm not sure that that's a possible comparison given the time. As I say, when we were exploring this and we looked at Torbay, they were 7 years down the line.
Yes.
We gave ourselves a five-year plan, which finishes next year, and we've achieved a number of the outcomes that we expected to. The IGBs are not in the same position, to be fair.
Although in places like East Renfrewshire, they've been running for 10 years. Places like West Lothian, it's been effectively running for 10 years or more.
Evaluation,
right,
to allow us to look at that. It would be nice to have some overall evaluation that was able to externally take a view about that.
So I think this is playing into the earlier theme as well, that the Scottish Government needs to be doing more in terms of benchmarking performance across the system, and including between the two different models.
Can I just add one very, very quick
very
point
quickly.
To that? Mr. Neil's talking about a single plan. I don't know if you can have a single plan, but there does need to be clarity around some of this. So we've talked about long-term financial plan, we've talked about clarity and outcomes, consistency in organisational arrangements. Can I suggest we also need to look at a new framework for delivery in adult social care and in adult services? Frankly, many of you in this room have heard me say this before, we need a GERFEC for adults. We don't have, Mr. Calderwood talked about what a nurse might do in commissioning social care. We haven't actually worked that out. We haven't actually thought that through. In children's services, we know what a nurse does, we know what a social worker does. We haven't worked that out yet in adult services.
But I would add to that is we need a national acute services plan.
Yes, okay. Which is integrated.
Absolutely.
It's not looking at acute separately.
That's right.
Okay. Alison Harris.
Yes, good morning. Well, I've been listening with interest to everything that's been said, and just a few things that have come through what's been said, if I could just maybe ask you, take you back to it. I think, Jan, earlier on I heard you say that you have to make this work, that it must be made better for the people. I just wanted to ask you, when actually do you think the people or the users or patients or whatever, you know, we're going to term them, when do you think they're actually going to see that this is an improvement?
Well, I think we're already capturing evidence of improvements being seen from work with our Highland Senior Citizens Network and our user groups across Highland. Interestingly, when we had the consultations with them, when we were developing the methodology and we were developing the model, they couldn't see why we hadn't done this years ago. You know, to them, they don't care who employs the staff as long as they get the services. So we are very consciously involving users and carers. And again, it goes back to communities and working with communities. And we are ensuring that we actually get that feedback. It's always quite difficult to make sure that we get it accurately. Do we get it at the point of someone having a service? On the way out, you get given an evaluation form. But we're looking at a whole range of ways of gathering that, and that informs our planning process going forward.
Okay. And, well, I'm conscious of time, so I did hear, Robert, that you said that, you know, obviously you're having less hospital time, less bed times, etc. But I did hear you say that on your acute side that you were £9 million overspent currently. Is that correct? Did I pick that up?
Correct, yes. Yeah.
With, you know, we've alluded to the fact that, you know, there's obviously problems with, you know, GPs obtaining consultants, etc. Are your locum costs high in Glasgow and are they contributing?
I pause only to determine in a Glasgow context what's high.
£9 million over budget. Well,
yes,
at this stage
yes,
is quite high by my books.
Well, yeah. My finance director would tell me that's less than point something of a percent. But no, I accept wholeheartedly. But the quick
and are you through your year end yet?
No.
Well, therefore, £9 million is a running over budget from
correct.
My books.
So. Absolutely. Okay. The quick answer to your comment is, we are finding that we are requiring to use more, particularly medical locums, in the last 2 years than has been a feature of the past. If you look only, I can only comment in Greater Glasgow and Clyde, but in Greater Glasgow and Clyde for senior medical staff, for consultants, we had a financial position where we were imbalanced. In other words, that our senior medical staff pay ran at about break-even or marginally an underspend each year. In the last 2 years, we have seen the introduction of significant payments to locums, so much so that our expenditure this year is likely to be about £12 million in senior medical locum. Now, that is driven by the fact that over recent years, the intensity of activity and the volume of activity has increased so much so that when an individual post is not occupied, then that can be either through maternity leave, vacancy, or sickness, there is a requirement to backfill. Now, that was not a phenomenon in the senior medical staff. It's always been an issue in junior doctors where there are rotas and there are the 48-hour working week compliance. So if a junior or a number of juniors in a rota were not at work for whatever reasons, there was always a culture of medical locums for junior doctors, which tended to be some of themselves doing locums. Senior consultants used to always just cover each other. We are now at a stage where in many specialties, you almost need 99% of your workforce at work to meet the status quo. So when they're not there, there is an immediate pressure, either through legal compliance, i.e. a consultant needs to be on duty or on call, or through making the performance targets, be it unscheduled care performance or be it scheduled care performance, these drive the need for the senior medics to be about. So that is a big cost pressure that's relatively new. The other thing that's relatively new for us in Greater...
question, yep. But can you keep your answer a bit short?
Well, I'll stop please. At that point.
Okay, yeah. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, yeah. Thank you. I had a few more, but I appreciate the time pressure, so thank you.
Okay, Gail Ross.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to draw the committee's attention to my register of interest, which states that I am actually a Highland councillor. I'd like to extend a personal welcome to Jan Baird and Bill Alexander. It makes me feel a bit more at home seeing you here today. And also to sincerely thank the officers and staff at Highland, both NHS and Highland Council, for all the work that has been undertaken. We know it hasn't been easy, but we shouldn't underestimate what has actually been done, and we're really proud of what you've all achieved. So sincerely, thank you. As we've heard, the lead agency model is not without its challenges, and I wanted to speak a little bit about the staff, because there were huge amounts of staff involved, and we know that some of them had to shift from one service to the other, and especially at a time where we were also in the middle of reforms within the education service, and you know there was a lot of things going on, and still are, to be fair. How did you make it work? How did you take the staff along with you, get them on board, information sharing, reassurance, and are they happy now?
To answer your first question, your second question, yes, they are happy. We understand none of them would like to go back to the way things were. Through the programme of change that we developed up to the point of integration, we had very great involvement with our staff and with unions. We had a separate partnership forum just for the programme of work so that we discussed all the developments and the way we were progressing the programme. We had staff side representatives on the programme board. We went out to staff groups across Highland and spoke to staff groups in their silos, as we might say, or in their facilities. We had a risk log and an issues log for all staff to contribute any issues that they felt. Our chief executives throughout the programme were quite clear: if at any time there was anything that was deemed unsafe, we would stop the whole process, and everyone knew that. We had, for example, some concerns raised by, through child protection and how that would all pan out, and our chief executives and Bill and I and others immediately met with paediatricians and child protection staff to listen to their fears and allay their fears and deal with issues right away. So we dealt with things as soon as they came up. Staff felt well supported. We did have more issues from staff transferring into the council, nursing staff transferring into the council, and we discovered in discussions with them that that was about grieving for the NHS. Actually, leaving the NHS was really difficult for them. Now they've made that change, they see that the improvements, and they're comfortable with it, but we had to support them through that particularly.
Okay. I could use that. And across Scotland there was a lot of concern about the fact that we were chooping 1500 staff one way and 200 staff the other way. Actually, in the main, the Chupi issue hasn't been a big issue. It was cultural issues. It was the branding. It was about different perceptions. There are still some oddities. You know, my health colleagues in the council have got different public holidays, which is a bit weird. And, you know, there are the odd grading issue. But in the main, the Chupi issue hasn't been the big issue. It has been the cultural issues that Jan referred to and working that through. And actually working through those things has been good. Has been good because people have more in common than they have apart.
Feel anything further?
No, that's brilliant.
Okay, Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Vera. I'm sure we'd all agree that one of the key requirements for success of this new model is that the IGBs receive adequate resources, both financial and other. Looking at the six IGBs under the Glasgow model, it would appear that every single IGB has had its budget cut. And I was wondering if you had any comment on that.
All six IGBs have got an increased resources in 16-17 versus 15-16 in absolute terms, in the same way as the Health Board has an increased allocation in 16-17 in cash terms compared to 15-16.
That appears to be at odds with the evidence we took on the 15th of September when we queried East Renfrewshire's allocation, which had been cut. And there was a confirmation from Julie Murray that both themselves and the other boards had received savings targets that had been handed down to them, and in fact the resources were cut.
Savings targets, absolutely. The government sets a minimum 3% efficiency target every year within the health service. The IGB and its health budget is part of the health service, therefore it's subject to the 3%. And yes, absolutely, every part of the business has to look at how it delivers its services on a year-on-year basis in a more effective and efficient way.
But all the IGBs seem to be struggling to get more resources in order to deliver this new model. It seems anomalous that the budgets are being cut at the same time as there's this imperative to increase the resources. Or to move the resources?
Well, I accept the point you're making. I would make two points. I think, firstly, if the Health Board receives an uplift in cash and it passes that uplift in cash on, but the cost of doing business as usual with real inflation is greater, that drives a need to look at and deliver your services in a more effective and efficient way. But in cash terms, you've had an uplift. Audit Scotland's report published this morning, if you look at section 11, it highlights specific decisions taken by Parliament to make cuts in budgets that are ring-fenced and passed straight through to IGBs. And if you take the fact that the board gets an uplift and you pay your staff more than the uplift, then you have inflationary pressures. It's an interesting debate in semantics about cuts.
Just simply seems to be that it seems odd to me that when we're trying to push resources or move resources from one area to another, that the area into which these resources are supposed to be transferred in order to deliver the new model is actually receiving budget cuts rather than more resources.
If I can answer the question in real terms, we had over 69 million savings target this year for 16-17 within Glasgow. 72% of that is sitting within the corporate and acute functions, 28% of it sitting within the partnerships. So relatively, our savings targets have not been proportionally split across the whole organisation. The brunt of them sits within the acute and the corporate divisions. So in relative terms, partnerships have to achieve savings of just over 2%, where other parts of the business are looking at 7 and 8%. So the shift in resources might not be the top level, but we are certainly striving to try to make sure that we are achieving that end result.
I'll leave it at that, just now.
Can I come back to something that was said right at the start of our evidence session? Mr. Calderwood, in response to Colin Beattie, you said the status quo prevents change. Can you tell me exactly what you mean by the status quo?
Yes, I mean, I can give you a practical example. At the present moment in time, we are out to a series of service changes, one of which is redesigning older people's services in the East End of Glasgow, and the proposal is to cut back in institutional services and invest in community services, and as a consequence of that, take away a standalone older people's hospital and close 56 beds. That has been the subject of debate in the Parliament as being something that is not welcome and not appropriate. That's what I call the debate that we have to get into between the status quo and the new world. You cannot, in the current financial climate, have both.
saying it's necessary to close hospitals if we are going to move towards true integration?
It is a requirement within the current budget that in order to do more locally in the patient's home or near the patient's home, you then have to take the resources that were previously in institutional care and disinvest and reinvest. The trick is in the timing, that trying to get that ability to invest in the new services while running the old service down. So there's an element of the people seeing the new before they see the loss of the status quo. But that is challenging in the current climates. But that is a practical example of where we have worked with the IGB to redesign a model for older people where we do not believe they need to be in an institution because of the changes. And we have put forward a proposal to release that resource and to reinvest it. Now, the outcome of that will be the outcome of that going through the appropriate channels. However, it has already attracted significant comment as being the wrong thing to do.
So, I mean, your definition of that status quo is really the difficult politics of this. Could you define the status quo as budgetary pressures as well, or is it just the politics you think are preventing the change?
Well, no. The changes, the changes that we aspire to do for the population of Scotland is multifactorial. I mean, we've debated at different aspects this morning about how we change the workforce. Can we get the workforce that we want? We've debated about the investment in the alternative services, which will include not only money and the new workforce, but it'll include capital. And what we're saying at the moment is that what I'm saying at the moment is if everything that we do tonight, in the sense of every building, every member of staff, and every way they work is protected, and we're going to talk about only investing the uplift, then regrettably, we are not currently in a financial position to give the public sector across the entirety of the public services real uplifts. So we have to redesign. We have to look at efficiency. We have to look at best practice. And my final point on this would be Catherine Calder, the Chief Medical Officer's report on realistic medicine. That talks about us not over-medicating the Scottish population, recognising that some things that we do don't add value, and we need to work with the population to persuade them that going to the GP and getting antibiotics every other week is not in their long-term best interest. That's what I mean about the status quo. Everything within the status quo has to be challenged. Not necessarily always you're going to get a change, but it has to be challenged. It can't start from the assumption it's good and everything you do next is a risk.
I mean, integration only very recently became statutory, but it's a process that's been ongoing for many, many years now. But we know that over the four-year period from 2010-11 to 13, the balance of expenditure on institutional services didn't shift at all. So, I mean, are you really saying that it's that complexity of reasons that's the reason for that? And when do you think it will shift?
Well, I think it's going to be a slow process because I think that we haven't yet won the hearts and minds of the public that some of the changes that we are planning are better than what they have. We have an issue within the acute sector that there has been a number of government initiatives over the years to improve the acute sector, to expand the acute sector in the context of range of treatments that we provide for the Scottish population. And we've had, different pay policy within Scotland compared to the rest of the United Kingdom, particularly aligned to low pay. And that has given that the headcount in the acute sector is higher than in the community primary care. Will an absolute top level always drive an apparent protection of costs in there? That's not because we're setting out to do that. It's just a factor of all of these things. So what I'm trying to say at the moment is that there are examples that individual boards are bringing forward whereby they want to redesign services, have less reliance on the older traditional model of institutional care in a hospital, to care in the community, and we need to work through that. And that will affect everything. I mean, if I join Greater Glasgow and Clyde tonight as an ITU nurse in a big critical care unit, I'm not immediately attracted when I hear the chief executive talk about care in the community. That's not what I do tonight, you know. So you have to work with your own staff as well, who you want to change their skill sets, deliver their services in a different environment.
Could I possibly just add that you talked earlier about and asked us earlier about what support government can give. The changes that we have to make are very emotional for a lot of communities, and we need support both in national government and local government when it comes to making those really difficult decisions. Because no matter what evidence we have about safety and sustainability, communities are absolutely committed to looking after buildings. And it's really, that's what they want in their community. And it's a really, really difficult task for us. And we need support where the evidence is there to make this shift. We can't actually do it on our own. We need the public to be behind us, but the public turn to their politicians, whether locally or in this parliament. And we actually need that support to make these changes consistently.
Can I thank you all very much indeed for your evidence this morning. It's been a long session and very much appreciated. I'm now going to suspend the committee for about 2 to 3 minutes and we'll move into private session. Thank you.